Hi, and welcome to another episode on Straight Up Tech. Let's learn together. So we have learned basic Unity environment and basic C# programming in our previous episodes. Today we are going to learn how to make our player move. Before we dive in, please don't forget to subscribe or click on the bell icon so you never miss a video again. Now, in the last video, we applied some force to move our player. As we know, in Unity, the friction is calculated between the player and the background to make the player move. Now we can control the amount of friction by just making a physics material, name it something like Frick. So what we'll do is, we'll go to create physics material and name it as Frick. Right now, drag and drop the material to the background. From here, you can control the amount of friction you want to have between your player and the background. And play. Okay. Now there is no friction between the ball and the background. You can control the friction according to your need from this window. Now let us open our player movement script. Now here you can see we are applying a force of 1000 on the z-axis and multiplying by time by delta time. Wouldn't it be cool if we can just get the value in real time instead of hard coding it in the function? To do that, we use variables. Just like you store item in a container, you can store data in a variable. In the basic, we learn to store simple values like number, text or decimals. But variables can be used to store way more complicated data types. Like we slap a name on a container, we can give our variable's name related to its use. We also have to specify the type of data we have to store. At first, remember the four fundamental data types: int, float, bool, string. The basic variable structure looks like this. You can name it like this. Now Unity allows us to edit a variable in the inspector too, that we have to mark our variable as public. Now currently this variable has a null value, so we can also apply some value to the variable and then we can get the value in the code by simply getting its name. We can also edit the value and so on. Now back to our player movement script. Now instead of hard coding the value here, we can make a public float variable named move forward. And initialize its value to something like 1000f. I am using f because we have to declare it as a float value. Otherwise, Unity might generate error. Now we write the variable in the function and play the game. What we'll do is write save it and then press play. See how the ball is moving. Now on the player console, you can see this move forward public variable here. From here you can control its speed. Say you put it to 500. Now press play. It is moving much slower now. You want it to move much more faster, you can change it to something like 2000. This is how you can control the public input of your variables from the inspector window. I'll go back to our script. Now we have to look at doing some player input so we can move our ball sideways. To do that, we will use if statement. Now you can write if function bracket, and this is the basic structure of an if statement. Now if statements are used to execute a certain code only if certain conditions are met. In our case it will be pressing a key. So if you will write something like input dot get key say d, and write move dot and add force then f comma 0. So if you press the D key, then automatically what will happen is you will add a force to the right of the player by this code. And if input get key move dot add force 0 minus 100 f 0. Now you can see that I have used a negative sign here. This is because the force will be applied in the same plane, but as I have to move left or right, so this will help it to move left and the other one move help it to move right. We can save our script and then press play. It's too fast. Don't do this. I'll set it up there. We will move it a bit back on the Z axis so we get a more playground to play with, and so reduce its speed to something like 200 so we can see what is happening. Save and see. Now when I press the A, now see when I press the A key and D, now it is moving very fast. Now as you have seen, the player is moving very fast. So what we'll do is we'll initialize a variable for the player input as well, and we'll call it something like public float move player, initialize it to something 10f, and what we'll do after this is we'll write move player here move. Now we will keep this negative sign intact because we will be getting positive values only when inputting the values in the move player. Save it, go back. Now you will be having a move player component in your player movement script, and you see the value is already set to 10. Now we will try it in this See, the ball is moving now. So this is how we can control the movement of a player using the function which I have defined in the script. But for the sake of the game which we are developing, we need to control our player both horizontally and vertically. To do that, again we'll go to our player movement script and remove all of his code that we have written. Now what I'll do is I'll write the basic functions, that is void start private, void fix update, now these are the two functions which I will be needing to explain to you another way in which we can control our player both horizontally and vertically. Now our player movement to work according to our project, we need to use the rigid body component of our player. For that you can see the player, the rigid body component is already attached to a player. If you don't see the rigid body component, you can always add the same from add component and then you can search for rigid body and you can add it from here. But as we already have a rigid body component, so we will go back to our script. And now as we need to get input from a player from every platform including mobile devices, we will use the function input.getAccess. Now since we have to store the data which we will get through the input.getAccess, we will use the float variables. And since there are physics calculations involved, we will run our code in fixUpdate. So it will be write void fixUpdate float move horizontally to get our horizontal movement is to input dot get axis and horizontally. Now this variable will store all the horizontal movements from our get access function, and for what we write float move vertical to input dot access vertical. Now since we are working with the rigid body component, we need to have a reference to the rigid body component. But first we will need to create a variable to hold that reference. So write a reference as private rigid body something like. Now I have told you before, you can create a reference to the another component unity by using a public variable. But there is another way in Unity, the component can be directly called in the following way, right? You will use the variable to store the value. Okay. Get component rigid body. Now we can access rigid body component through our player movement script. Now since we need the reference only during initialization, we'll put the line of code in void start. Now since we are moving our player only in two axes, we have to initially set a value to a vector 3 variable. Now what is the vector 3 variable? Vector 3 variable is a function which can store the value for your x, y and z axis. Now to create the vector 3 variable and to store our horizontal and vertical value to it, what we'll do is the vector 3 variable 3 and we name it as move to new vector 3 and put our values as move horizontal. Now since we don't need to move in the y axis, we will just initialize it as 0 and move. What we have done here is we have put our horizontal and vertical data into a move vector 3 variable. Now we add the force to our player according to the keys pressed on the keyboard or according to the input. So to add the force, what we'll do is we'll use the rigid body variable, that is body dot add force, and we'll get the data of force through our move variable. Save this. Go to Unity. Now you see that all the variables, public variables which we have created, are no longer there. Just play. Now we can control our player through our keyboard. See, I'm pressing the forward key, the backward key, the left key, the right key. So for the sake of our game, as we needed to control our player through our keyboard keys, we have used these functions. Now you can also control the speed of your player by initializing a public float variable named speed, and you can multiply your move to the speed variable. Initialize the speed variable to, I don't initialize it to anything. So now what happens is now you have a speed variable which is currently set to 0. You set it to something like 100 and then press play. Oh, it is too fast. Then put it to something like 20, then press play. This is also very fast, but now you can understand the basic concept how we can control our player in two different ways. So I hope you understood how we can control the players. You can play around with the controls, and that's all for this episode. Please do subscribe and press the bell icon so you never miss a video again. Thank you for watching Straight Up Tech and have a great day.